It's Mo again. It's been a while since I've been able to have some free time to make some more content, but we got a special treat for you guys today. This is one of the more popular lines of amplifiers that's currently out on the market. As you've seen, if you're in the car audio realm and world, the whole debate about half bridge, full bridge, a lot of new brands on the market that are really popular, very sound. Brands like TARAMPS, Sound Digital, obviously Sundown Audio has their SFB, which this probably looks identical to it. But what you have here is a full bridge monoblock amplifier. These are really, really popular in the fact that they put quite a bit of power out in a very compact profile. So you can see this isn't much bigger than my hand here. And this is a 3 kilowatt RMS into a 1 ohm load. Very similar to the TARAMPS 3000, identical to the Sundown SFB 3000.D. Same as the Sound Digital, same as who else makes it? I believe Timpano makes it. You've got other brands like PRV. I believe even Wolfram made it. But this is a unique product line where, because it's really sponsored by a good friend of ours, and that is Patrick from Robot Underground. So he's got the line of GONZO amplifiers at an amazing price. Obviously his service, if you've had an opportunity to watch his video, top notch, backs it up with a multi-year warranty on all of his products. And this was one of the ones that came in under warranty, and what he did for his customers, just replace it. And we had the opportunity to chat, and I picked this up from him to see what was wrong with it. It's currently dead, and so I want to go ahead and take this opportunity to diagnose it with you guys, understanding that there's not a lot of content on these. I think people are a little hesitant to work on them just because of how new they are. So maybe this is a good opportunity for us to go ahead and check it out together, see why it's not working, and they kind of get a little bit of understanding of why these are so popular. And obviously there's a reason why every brand takes that same build and slaps their name on it and charges varying prices. But I personally have one of these, similar to these, in my truck. The reason for that is I tend to kind of, there's mixed opinions out there, but I tend to have more power capacity than I need for my subwoofers. So I like having something this small and compact in my vehicle. But again, I'm only requesting, or requiring about 1,000 to 1,200 watts RMS. And so it's good to know that I have, quite a bit left, anywhere from 1,000 to 1,800 watts of RMS power. So that allows me to, first of all, not stress the amplifier. And usually at the lower power levels, you tend to also be more efficient. So, not only are you not stressing the amplifier, you're not dissipating a lot of heat where you're storing this amplifier, but overall very, very popular. This particular one takes one odd, or one gate or zero gauge, power input for the power and the ground. Looks like, 8 gauge remote. Not sure why it needs to be that big. Again, the remote wire is a small signal wire. It's just a 12 volt with almost minimal current, just enable the amp to turn on or off. This is a, if it's tricky, but Tiffany style RCA jacks, and the Tiffany kind of really just means that the fact that you can screw it externally with these little nuts on the outside, but you see the input and output, so you can link a couple. Doesn't mean you can strap them, but at least you can have a passive run through for the subwoofer signal itself. I know on my particular one, I'll have to look at the manual for this. On the one I have, you can actually place both left input and right input in instead of having to get a T that drops it down to a single input. I see 8 gauge speaker output terminals, as you can see, 1 ohm minimum. This is where it does its most power, 3000 RMS. Again, full bridge topology, pretty efficient, pretty robust. I do see for the cooling aspect of it, it does have 2 active cooling or forced convection. This is dual fans. And if it's similar to all the other amplifiers, they are not always on. They're intermittent and they're based on power output as well as the temperature sensing inside of the amp. So as you pull more current, they're going to turn on, keep everything cool. As they sense the heat sink is heating up, they'll turn on. So they're not always on, which is great. So with that being said, let's go ahead and get into the diagnostics. As usual, the first thing I want to do is just kind of look at the input to make sure the 12 volt and the ground are not shorted, as well as remote. We can also look at the output to make sure that those aren't shorted. And that way we can just start kind of doing process of elimination. I actually haven't even put power on this. So I don't even know. Patrick just said it was dead. So maybe I after I check the inputs and the outputs, I'll go ahead and just apply low current 12 volt signal and see if we even get it into the protect mode. So I thought I saw a few LEDs here somewhere. There you go. So you've got the power, you've got a clip indicator, and you got protection. So very similar to all the other designs as well. And usually these have remote controls or base knobs that have those built in, but these didn't come with it. So let's go ahead and dive in and see what we can find. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and put my multimeter here on resistance. And what I wanna do, as I mentioned, I'm gonna measure to see if there's any shorts in between the plus and minus. Usually if there's an immediate short or low impedance or low resistance, that means that the input is shorted out, which most of the time these FETs will fail open, just because they tend to be very dramatic. So let's see, on the 12 volt to the ground. Okay, we're seeing like 70 something kilo ohms. And if I switch polarity, see, it's negative. So you've got some, it sees the capacitance on the input. So I don't see a short immediately. When I go to 12 volts to remote, again, very high impedance, about 600 kilo ohms. So that's good. Remote to ground, also very high impedance, 470K. So that's good. Things aren't shorted on the input. Doesn't mean it's not bad. Now let's look at the speaker terminals. Now I see here, I've got the two negatives on the left and two positives on the right. This is a monoblock, so they're technically tied in together. So when I do the two negatives, it should zero out. And there you go, 0.4 ohms. And when I do the two positives, it should also be the same, 0.4 ohms. Now, what it shouldn't be is if I do positive and negative. And again, I see high impedance, so the output is not shorted. That's good. Okay. So that being said, I want to go ahead and just kind of apply some power to it and see what it looks like. All right, so I am here at my workbench, and what I want to do right now, since I haven't powered it on just yet, I want to go and power it on. And so what I usually do in this case is I look at my benchtop power supply and I will current limit it. So I'll try to minimize the current draw on here. And the way to figure it out is go ahead and turn it on. This is safe, so don't worry about it, is actually shorting out the output. That way it draws the current, and you know how much you can actually current limit it to. So when I turn this on, here's where it's going to show me how much current I can limit it to. So I'm just going to leave it about an amp and see if it's going to trip right there. When I turn it off and disconnect the output, I can now go back and turn it on to look at my voltage. And I usually try to keep it around 14 volts or 14.4. So right now it's showing 0 amp draw because I don't have it connected to any load. So I'll go ahead and turn it off and I will come around here. And hey, shouts out to this guy, Robot Underground. Go check him out. All right, so I see my 12 volt and my remote. So what I'm going to do is try to get them both with just one alligator clip. I may have to use two. And then I'll just connect my ground at the end here. Again, I've got one alligator portion touching both the 12 and the remote, and then just one portion touching the ground without touching the exterior chassis. So let's turn it on, see if it's got good contact. It's pulling current. That's good. Oh, current limiting. So let's see what's going on here. I hear the fans kicking on. Okay, you can see I'm current limiting. It looks like I'm close. Maybe I'll turn up the current just a little bit. See what's happening here. I do hear it turning on. Let's see here. Yeah, look, I got a Christmas show. So power's flashing. Protect kicks on. Clipping. So it looks like it's stuck in recycling mode. And what that's doing right now, every time the amp turns on, it's running a self-check diagnostic. As I've mentioned in a couple of my videos, most amps have all the same protection circuitry. Fundamentally, it's going to be the overcurrent. So if you draw too much current, it's going to shut down to protect itself so it doesn't blow all the internals. It will have a temperature sensor or multiple sensors, either on the heat sink, on the board, next to devices, thermistors. And what that does, once it gets above a certain temperature, it will shut down and protect itself as well. And usually also another protection it'll have is overvoltage. So if you exceed a certain threshold, let's say more than 16 volts or so, it will also shut down. Very similar, also do under voltage. So what I'm seeing here now, it's trying to start and it's going through cycling through the different protection circuitry and looking at the feedback circuit. And what it's seeing is there's issues. I can't quite start. I think I can start. No, I can't. But I do hear it going. And you can see the fluctuation of my power supply here, right? It's trying to go, but when it thinks it's going to go, then all of a sudden it pulls too much current and it goes in protection mode. So, cool. That's good. That's good in the sense of an amplifier that is doing what it's supposed to do, protecting itself. So the next step now is to go ahead and shut down my power supply, short out the input so I can at least minimize any charge in those input capacitors. And then we'll open it up, see what we got. So shut that off. And here we go. All right, so let's go ahead and take it apart and see what we've got in here. Looks like about four corner screws for the bottom plate. And so you will see a lot of these are, how do I say it? On Marketplace, on OfferUp, on eBay, that are for sale that are damaged. And there's a big business for repairs of these amplifiers for many reasons, but one of the more popular reasons and the most dominant reason is folks treat these like half-bridge amplifiers. Half-bridge and full-bridge, as far as sound quality, as far as a capability for subwoofers or full range, are actually behaved very, very similarly. But the topology in the half-bridge is actually more tolerant of being able to handle lower impedances. And so a lot of the times that folks get, you know, these amplifiers that are either 3,000 watts RMS. There's another one that's 5,000 watts RMS. I believe the next lineup that Patrick at Robot Underground has is 8,000 RMS, and I'm sure there's more. But for folks that are really looking for that much power, usually they're driving subwoofers that are, you know, dual, you know, 2 ohms, and they have multiple, let's say 2, 3, 4. And at the end of the day, what happens, the biggest mistake is that they'll wire them down in a configuration that gets you below the 1 ohm minimum that you can go on these amplifiers. And anything on a full bridge, if you go below 1 ohm, you're bound to blow them up. They just can't handle it. And that's why, you know, that's the reason why they're so small, is with the full bridge topology, you're actually able to use kind of a full H bridge topology, but use a lot less devices, right? So the devices are working less hard than maybe a full bridge, but a full bridge has so many more devices that can actually handle a little bit more current draw. Hence why you can probably go to lower impedance, because lower impedance is going to draw more power. So that is usually why they fail. So let's take a look at this from my history. Usually there is a dead giveaway when you look at here, but let's just do a visual and see if anything stands out. And go from there. As usual, let's see if I have a good look in this. There we go. I pick sections. And I go down the sections to see if anything stands out. already not liking a couple things. You can see the imprint on the electrolytic aluminum capacitor here. I don't like that they are, it's not quite bulged, but usually as those look a little bit more extruded, that means it's seen a lot of temperature and heat. So I don't like that, but I wouldn't think that's pushing in protection unless it is shorted out. So let me keep looking over here. Okay, I do see some residue on one of the ICs, maybe two, but again, this is just a visual. So if I point, see if you can see it here. If you can look at this corner, you can see there's a slight reflection. And it looks a lot glossier, like it's gotten a lot more heat. So it's possible. And then I also see a similar gloss right on one of the edge of this IC here. So I'll have to determine what that is and take a look. And then maybe start measuring around and see if there's anything that is burnt up. But visually, I don't see any FETs that are blown, which is good. But again, that doesn't mean anything until I actually get my multimeter to them and look at the gate to source, source to drain, and look if there's any opens or shorts. Usually with a FET like this, they should all be open. And the only thing you'll be able to read is a pull up or pull down resistor. We can also look at the gate, look at the gate resistance to make sure it's consistent. But again, the thing that sticks out like a sore thumb to me is definitely this IC here, which is, if I can read with my eyes, says U4, maybe U4. So I'll take a look at it and let's just start looking at the measurements of each FET. All right, but overall really clean. I don't smell anything in it. So let's dive on in. All right, so now let's look at the input side. So here's the input power. You've got your input coils and input FETs with the rectifier on this end. And then you've got your output stage. Actually, the rectifier may be on this end. No, rectifier is on that end. So let's look at the input side. Again, we didn't see any shorts. So what I'm gonna do is measure source to drain and then look at the gate to see if there's anything wrong with the gate resistors or potentially the gate drive. So first FET. Let me put this in here so you guys can see it a little bit better. Maybe that. Okay. So that looks like 10K for the first FET. And then second FET, 10K. That's good. Third FET, 10K. That's good. All right. That looks good. That looks good. All right, and I think the next ones are also the FETs. So there we go, 9.96K. So that's a 10K ohm resistor. And this one looks like it's got epoxy on it. So maybe I need to just carefully unscrew the heat sink and do another visual. And when I say heat sink, it's these aluminum blocks that basically put force on the MOSFET down. These MOSFETs are intended to really dissipate from the bottom, TO220 package, something like that. And what it does, it just makes enough force on the device itself against this heatsink. At the same time, you've got fans across both rows here that help maintain further cooling. So that being said, let me look at this. It's got a little sleeving on there, so I just got to peel that back a little bit. 9.96K. So all of the inputs are fine, input FETs, as far as visual, and looking at the source to drain. So they're not shorted, they're not open, which is good, and they're consistent. So what I want to do now is also look at the output side to see if there's an issue and go from there. So let me put this back. And another thing that I mentioned earlier, how right away they usually pop up with these amps, is there is a layer of Kapton that's used as an insulator. It's probably very hard to see here. It's kind of this shiny reflective strip. I can just get a better visual. That sits right behind the FET. So you can see kind of the border change here. That reflective area is a thin layer of Kapton, which is a great insulator. And they do that so it doesn't short to the chassis, as far as since the top portion's actually connected to the source, I believe. Usually when they go bad or the FETs go bad, you will actually see discoloration before you even take anything apart once you open the plate. And what happens is the FETs get so hot, they transfer that heat to the Kapton and it exceeds really what it does, and the Kapton starts either boiling or discoloring and starts to deteriorate. So right away you can usually tell, but I didn't see that on here, which is good. Again, it looks like more it's a small signal issue than it is an actual power issue. So let's just continue to try to troubleshoot it and see where it takes us. Okay, so I turned it around. We already measured the input stage. Now it's time to kind of look at the output stage. Again, there's four FETs here for the output, full bridge. And then you've also got the rectifiers here. So we'll measure those. All right. Can you guys see the multimeter okay? Okay, so that side shows to be a short 4.2 ohms. Okay, let's look at the next one on that leg. That's 9.96 kiloohms. Okay, so that's right. See the other side of the bridge, 4.4 ohms, okay, 9.96. So it does look like one of the sides is completely shorted. Let me look at the rectifiers, and usually this is anode to cathode, should be open. Correct, and if I turn it around, should read. There you go. Do the same thing here. This should be a high resistance. There you go. If I switch it around, should be an open. Good. Same. Let's go over here. All right, turn it around. Good, and then leave that there. Get the other side, oops, sorry. Was that right? It should be open. Turn around, should be reading some 200 something. There you go. So I think the rectifiers are fine. What I wanna do now is just look at the output stage. It looks like I don't want to rush to conclusion. Sometimes maybe the gate drive just has it kind of turned on, which means be shorted, but it really shouldn't do that if there's no power. So most likely we took out one leg of the full bridge, and what it did is just kind of short, and it's shorted enough that it put in protection mode without actually damaging the FETs. So let me unscrew these and see if there's a reading. On the Sundown SFB series, which I've repaired a few of, Sundown actually took all the FETs and removed the silk screen off of them and labeled them with their own nomenclature. So it was actually like A1 or A2 or some sort of alphanumeric code. That way someone didn't open it up and see what they used as far as design. Granted, everyone's already copied this design. In fact, Sundown even copied this design because they were not the original ones. I'll have to kind of reach out to Patrick and see who was the original designer of these amplifiers, but hey, save everything. Let's see if we can read this and I probably need better lighting and my eyepiece. So 1 second, I'll be right back. Okay, so got my handy looking glass here. I probably should take this tag off. This helps me when I'm not at the workbench, just to kind of be able to look at things that are very small. And in looking at this, and I'm sorry, I'm gonna have to see if I can get it in here with good lighting, but this also does not have the silk screen originally from the manufacturer. And all these FETs saying is gonna be very hard to tell is P1. See if I can get the right reflection to read it. And so these are designated as the P1 MOSFET. And there's a range of these, but overall they're going to be consistent across the same builds from Sundown, from Wolfram, from Sound Digital, even from TARAMPS. So what I will do is I am gonna look at my previous notes of what FETs. In fact, I'm gonna go back to my DigiKey order and see what I ordered as far as this package, and kind of compare that FET. After that, what I'll do is, just to make sure the FETs are really bad, I'll completely remove the board, removing all the heat sinks. I see about 6 screws that hold it in place. This will allow me to lift it off, including kind of the edge here. That way I can get real complete access to these FETs, knowing that most likely 2 of them are bad and the amp did exactly what it was supposed to do, and it sees something went wrong, it just protects itself. And so that's currently what we saw on the bench. That being said, I will figure out which FETs I can replace these with, make sure to see if I have them. If not, we'll get them ordered, swap them out once I confirm that they are bad. And hopefully that should take care of it. Again, these are pretty robust amps. Like I said, you'll see a lot of damage, but they're not because of the design. They're not because of the manufacturing. Most of the time it is user error. A lot of folks who love car audio, it doesn't always align with understanding car audio, right? And the difference in impedance and how you overwhelm an amplifier could have a dramatic impact on the operation itself. So let's look through and see what part number it is, and I'll make sure to put it in the comments in case you do have a very similar issue and you want to replace these for the 3K amps. And hopefully we can get this up and running again. All right, so I left off where I needed to take the heat sinks off, but one thing I noticed that I wanted to make sure captured is I noticed this coil was loose. There's a reason why they fill it with epoxy. You can see around there, there's black epoxy. Under this particular one, it's all white, and it's to stabilize the larger components on there, including the caps, big transformers. That way, as you can see, there's a lot of vibration in vehicles, especially with bass, especially with 3000 watts of bass. So you always want to usually secure the parts, but I did notice that this is loose. And again, it'll be good that I'm taking the board out. That way I can get a visual to see if there's any broken leads or anything like that. But I did just want to show this before the board completely came out. The board does have 6 Phillips head screws that hold the physical board to the chassis here. So there's 3 on this side in between the FETs, and then there's 3 more on this side. The next thing I'm going to do, instead of trying to disassemble everything here, I am just going to remove where the sides attach to the actual chassis. And so there's 4 Allen wrench keys, or torque wrench, whatever you want to call them, that I'm going to take here, 4 from each side. And once I do that, I should be able to lift the entire board with these wings or side panels attached to it, which will make it a lot easier for me to work with. But I did just want to point this out. Part of the visual and obviously mechanical inspection is, this is not normal, right? You don't want things like that. If you ever see it and your amp still works, just tack it down. Some good old silicone will do the job. Some good epoxy will do a good job. Again, I think most of these guys also use kind of a silicone-based adhesive, RTV, or even some epoxy for these larger, heavier components. But you can see that they're also around the larger caps, because on the micro scale, these caps actually expand and contract. That's just part of operation. Most all capacitors, unless they're ceramic, which has a different operation, but even ceramic resistors are actually, you know, they have different polarities and they will expand on a very microscale level. That's why reverse voltage on ceramics is not good, as well as these larger ones here. Over time, there's a liquid, they're kind of, the dielectric itself will dry out and it will stop expanding or contracting and eventually just dries out and you see no capacitance. Therefore, you don't have any energy storage. All right, so let me go ahead and take these off and we'll pull the board out, see what it looks like from the bottom. All right, so we've got four screws to take off. Again, these are the ones that are connected to the physical chassis itself, the outside shell. So by just removing the outside four screws from each side, what that's going to do now is allow us to go ahead and pull the whole assembly out of the chassis. As I mentioned earlier, looking at these FETs, I believe this is the output side, just because it's so close to the output here. Two are shorted, so they do read kind of that 0.4 ohms. Everything else measured out fine, so I'm hoping to replace those. I have replaced a similar FETs on a different brand, and I was actually able to dig in my inventory and see which FET I used to replace them with, and it was the International Rectifier brand. So this is IRFB4321PBF, which means lead free. These are 150 volt, 83 amp MOSFETs. And so I actually had purchased these for the same Sundown SFB3000D model. And as I was mentioning earlier, where they removed the silkscreen and put their own proprietary, if I focus on this, you're right here, you'll see that it says H6. So that is kind of at least Sundown's way of removing the actual manufacturer marking and putting their own kind of alphanumeric code on there. So that way they know what FETs they're using and no one else can copy it. Sorry about the blurriness, but hopefully you caught it right there. It does say H6. So these were from the Sundown SFB 3000D, which this is a complete identical replica of it. And again, it is the same design. I was looking last night just to kind of see how many manufacturers make it. Boy, there's a lot more than I expected. DS18, NVX, Slapz Audio, Sundown, Wolfram, certain TARAMPS. So it's a common design that people can take. They know it's a good design. It puts out a ton of power. And so it makes sense. So here's the actual replacement. Now I don't have enough. Let me see if I can get you to focus here. There we go. So this is it. I don't have enough. I just have one. And so I will be ordering more. I am hesitant to go ahead and push purchase because I do have a couple more from Patrick that he sent me. In fact, we'll include it in this video. But since this is just one spare, I'm handling it without being grounded. So please don't do that because of ESD, as I mentioned in some other videos. So that being said, I will use these as replacements. But before I do and confirm that that is really what's wrong, I want to pull it out carefully. I already mentioned I've gotten all the screws out, four on each side. So I will carefully lift the board, make sure there's no other screws holding it down. It looks like it's all coming up pretty easily. So let's see if it's going to let me with these big old fans in the way. And it may not. So I may have to disassemble is it going to? Oh, sorry about that. It's blurry. Excuse me. Okay, so now I'll take a little gentle prying effort. What I may have to do is just remove one of the fans, and that's not a big deal. So let me do that. It looks like only two screws are holding one fan in. So I will just remove one fan, and that should allow me to just pull it out relatively easy. Let's see, is this too big of a head? Yes, it is. So we will go with a smaller screwdriver. Okay, too small. Awesome. All right. So let me see if I have my medium size Phillips head here. It doesn't look like I have it on me, but I do have my drill. And let's see if this should work. Perfect. Okay, so get these loosened up. Pull this out. It should loosen the fan up a little bit. There we go, we got the fan is loose, and we should be able to just pull this out, hopefully, without stressing anything else. There we go. All right. You gotta be careful when you're handling this. So what I'm gonna do now, just so I minimize any loose hardware being missing, is I'm just gonna put these screws back in. There we go, just line it up. Sorry about being out of the screen here. Then I won't tighten them all the way, that way when I put it back on, it's less work. Okay, so I'm gonna flip this over and just to kind of again do a visual, see if there's any burnt marks, broken solder joints, build of liquid, anything else that could stand out like a sore thumb. Again, at the end of the day, this is a standard board, right? It's a 62,000s thick board, 62 mils, and it's just like any of your other electronics. So it's really dependent on these copper traces. Now for power devices, they use like a heavier copper pour is what they refer to. So you usually want to do 2 ounce or heavier copper pour. But again, they're susceptible to a lot of current running through a conductor. If it eventually overloads it, it basically acts as a fuse. So it will just explode. I don't see anything that stands out here other than just the normal reflow. So what I am going to do now, since knowing that two FETs are bad, I'm going to remove those two FETs first. I'm going to go ahead and put it on my portable not multimeter, oscilloscope, which has a built-in IC tester. So I want to make sure that they are bad. Usually when you take one, the other one will be okay. But I like to actually, if I realize which one it is, it doesn't matter. I'm going to replace all four because they're all the same four part numbers, and you get four brand new FETs, put it in there and do it right. Should be the only problem. So good. So we'll go from there. While I have you guys on, I'm going to go ahead and look at another amplifier that Patrick was able to send me. And I want to carefully put this on its back. All right. Keep this out of the way. Let my OCD kick in and leave that there. I've got another one here. This one I can smell from a mile away. It definitely has some burnt up stuff in there. I see Patrick at Robot was kind enough to document it. So Alex and Wilcox, it looks like you blew this up pretty good. And I also heard something in there earlier, if I'm not mistaken. There we go. So there's something loose. I'm not sure if it's a screw, blown part. Oh, there it is. It sounds pretty heavy or whatever it is. So we'll open it up, take a look, and see what's in here. So let's do it. All right, and for some reason, I cannot find my medium size Phillips, so hopefully this works. Yep. Let's get more picture. Apologize about the video, guys. This is the same exact amplifier. I'm just gonna refer to them as a 3000. There's another version that Patrick sent. So I got a total of 4 amplifiers from Patrick to look at. And these first two are identical. They're the monoblock, so single channel output, 3000 watts. Let's see, get these in another package. I'll just put them here for now. And so, yeah, wanted to kind of compare. Probability of being the same fault is probably minimal, just because, as I mentioned earlier, everyone, there's so many different things that can happen. So things just get damaged. And wow, this is pretty bad. So Alex, good job. I hope you didn't damage anything else in your electrical system. Right away, I will take my camera and show you guys right here what we've got. So there you go. This looks like the input stage. That's completely blown. Hot enough that it completely melted and blew up the aluminum block that attaches to the heat sink on the first pair. Burnt up the second pair pretty good. Looks like the third pair, fourth looks decent. And so, wow. Yeah, this is some pretty good damage. Now I know it was didn't work. Again, these are pretty robust. They are good amps, but I would lean towards the majority of problems usually being user error, whether they were shorted on the inside, outside, over voltaged, or something like that. Oh, this is interesting. Oh, this is what I heard. Okay, so we've got chunks of the heatsink or solder. I'm guessing this might be the heatsink or either or both. Yeah, wow. Okay, so right away, we know that this did some pretty good damage. I have not put this on a power supply to see if it turns on or not, just because I heard something was inside. I'm not even sure if this fan is melted or not. So I will follow the same procedure. I'll take this apart. I'll remove all of those FETs. I'll have to figure out what part number these are. I think I have, again, those documented somewhere. Sorry about the blurriness. I'm not sure what's going on with the lighting here. So I'll remove everything, clean it out, determine the part, and then find some alternate heat sinks. Again, these are just square blocks, so they should be relatively abundant. If not, I can always kind of cut something out, but I try to maintain the same parts used on these amplifiers, especially if I'm going to go ahead and put them back on the market. Again, anything I repair or fix, usually I will sell with the notification that's either been repaired, but it's very minimal. Everything that I usually repair for you guys is just for this content and for my enjoyment, really, not for profit. So cool. All right, so 2 of the same amps, 2 completely different failures thus far. Again, this looks more like it's on the input stage, or the input power comes in, which is interesting because usually this is the output stage with the, well, it varies from 1 to 1, but this looks like the input stage. So it got some, you know, a lot of current, and if he didn't have a big enough fuse, or I'm sorry, a small enough fuse, let's say that an amp like this, it usually needs a 300 amp fuse. So you've got to have that between your power source, whether it's directly from the front battery or a secondary battery, or you know, some people have these larger capacitor banks, etc. Really got to have a fuse in between, because that's your safety mechanism. These do not have fuses built in, right? They have protection circuitry, but it's small signal protection circuitry. So it can only do so much, but if you overwhelm it with a lot of energy, a lot of power, it's just going to give out. You see more dramatic damage like this on the input, just because you have a source with a lot more power, like a battery or capacitors, versus the output, where you're really seeing a load. You're seeing kind of an inductive load, which is the coil of a subwoofer or multiple coils. So, you know, it's limited, and usually, you know, the circuitry will kick in faster, but major explosions will usually be on the input power supply. So this will be a lot more work. It's a good thing why I was hesitant to go ahead and pull the trigger on procuring these FETs. because I will probably have to figure out what these FETs are, procure those, and hope that all the small signals fine and that they just blew open and didn't damage anything else. Okay, thank you, stay tuned, and we'll see what happens.
All right, guys, so brought the board to the bench. I was able to take all four output FETs off. So here is 1, 2, 3, 4. Got those off, and those are actually right here. The two that we're measuring short, I kind of took the sleeve off to differentiate, and then there's two that still have the sleeves on that were good. And I have this handy oscilloscope, just a portable one that I use to be able to test good FETs and bad FETs. This one is still measuring good, but it again probably saw some stress. And so what I'm gonna do is, again, just replace all four. Another thing I wanted to show is I went ahead and connected power with all of the FETs removed on the output stage. As you saw earlier, it was struggling for the protection. It couldn't turn on. It kept kind of recycling back and forth. So I went ahead and just powered on to see what kind of behavior it's got. So let's do that. You can see it kind of pulls up quite a bit of current initially, comes up here. And now we don't have it in protect mode. We do see the clip light on, but that could be associated with the fact that you don't have any output FETs. But power is constant, right? It's not recycling, which is good. And that's also a good sign as far as other repairs. So understanding that it's probably those four FETs that need to be replaced. I will go ahead and replace those. And as you can see, I just connected it the same exact way. You can slowly hear the fan. I don't know if you can see it here, but the fans are going at a very low speed, which is really cool because you don't have to be burdened with the sound of them as you're driving in a vehicle when the amp is just on and not actually powering anything. So that's pretty cool. Good results overall. And I think the next step is to go ahead and get the FETs in and see how that behaves. And hopefully there's nothing else that leads us to a rabbit hole. Okay, guys. So was able to go ahead and replace the FETs. These are the four FETs that I referred to earlier. As you can see, the IRFB 4321, got those in, went ahead and installed them for the output stage where we measured that the first, let's see if I can get my finger in there, first and the third were shorted, and measuring low impedance. So was able to go ahead and remove all four FETs, replace all of them with brand new FETs, got them soldered back on. I am applying power right now. As you can see, the power is on, so no protection circuitry kicking in and no clip indicator. Before I powered it on, I did go ahead and take measurements across the source and drain of each FET just to make sure there were no shorts, so that's good. We had the first one measuring 25K, second one measuring 10K, third is 25K, and then another 10K. So it looks like it's probably part of the gate drive. And as you can see here, we've got power, no clip indicator, no protection indicator. We've also got the fans up and running. There you go, for what it's worth. Now, I don't have it in the heat sink, so I'm not gonna run a lot of power to it until I start putting things back. But I do wanna go ahead and connect it where I can apply some small signal to see if there's any output. I'm gonna try to be very, very, very careful. Again, as there's no heat sink, so there's not a lot of ways to pull the heat out of the FETs, and I don't wanna damage any more FETs, so I don't have to replace it. But overall, pretty cool. Hopefully we got it one working one, so let me just do the final setup and we will test to see if there's output. All right, so got a very, very, very temporary setup going. I've got the outputs, running to just a dummy, well, not really a dummy, a single 4-ohm 8-inch subwoofer just sitting kind of on my bench, and went ahead and connected the RCA input. Again, I have to verify with Patrick if this model allows for both inputs and they're coupled in together at the input, or if you can only use just one of the RCAs. Again, traditional subwoofer channels are only supposed to have one. When you see two on the channels, it's long story short, but you can watch Patrick's videos on that. Okay. And again, same power supply, same everything. So let me go ahead and power it on. I want you guys to look at the behavior of when it does kick on. Again, it goes through its cycling. Christmas tree, protection, checks everything's okay. I've got approximately 900 milliamps or almost an amp of current draw, 14.3. And so let's apply some music and see if there's any output. Okay guys, we've got output, which is great. So I think this is the time where I start putting it back in the chassis, get it all buttoned up. What I will do is I believe I have some more thermal medium. It is important when you take these amps out that you do replace the thermal epoxy that goes on the back of it. I use, I believe it's a silver base, so let me just put it in a video here. It is thermal compound, so superconducting thermal compound. Very similar to the thermal grease that they use on the back of FET. So first of all, let me turn the power off. And I have somewhere the old FETs around here. I can show what was on the back of those. Might have dropped the bag. Where'd I put the bag? Here we go. Let me pick it up. So I probably can't see, but on the back of these FETs, they had some good thermal grease, which basically allows it to couple the heat and the heat dissipation to the heat sink. So there's that white thermal grease. They usually use the white stuff's the cheapest stuff you can get because it's in mass production. So I do like to kind of mix it with this really thermally conductive medium here. And so that just helps pull the heat away. So I will add a little bit of this below each of the FETs on this side. In fact, I'll probably just put a little dot. And you don't need to use a lot because as you compress these with the aluminum blocks, it spreads out. So, but overall successful. Again, it's not really completely done. I'm going to do one final run once I assemble it the same way we disassembled it, is go ahead, package it up, wire it up properly, running these, you know, bigger 12 gauge wires directly to the amplifier, hooking this up instead. I think this is only limited to like 10 amps. I've got a heavier duty power supply here that I will go ahead and connect it to so it can draw more current and try to maximize this. I'm not going to be able to get 3000 watts, unfortunately, but I think just running probably what a few hundred watts for some time to kind of get some temperatures built up and see if there's any errors. But overall, this is great, successful. Glad we can kind of do this simple repair. I do have a challenge ahead of me with the second version of this that we saw in the earlier video where it was completely destroyed on the input stage. Haven't had a chance to really kind of look at that and start cleaning it up, but I wanted to put this out. Hopefully this helps a lot of folks. A lot of these amps, again, very good amps, very powerful amps, very compact, well built. Most of the issues that you will see are usually user error, with some exceptions out there. So thank you all for watching. Thanks Robot Underground for allow me to kind of take this repair and share it with everyone. And again, you guys reach out to Patrick, very informative videos, amazing customer service, great products. You'll learn a lot if you really like car audio. So just stay tuned for one last video and here we go. Okay, one last thing as I'm putting back the amplifier, putting everything back in the chassis. One thing I failed to mention is we wanted to secure the loose toroid here. And so what I've got is E6000, which is kind of a silicon-based product. So it should be enough just to hold it in place. I did check the solder joints on this and there was no issues.
as far as continuity or anything like that. So I didn't have to reflow it or anything. It just came off the existing epoxy. So I am going to place it all around here and let it dry off before I do anything. But overall, it's all put back together. I've got the heat sinks placed on the input stage. I've got the heat sinks put on all the new FETs. As I mentioned, I used a thermal adhesive here. Just a little dab, again, very, very little dab on the bottom of each FET. And I went ahead and put them on all of them since I took it off. Placed back all six screws on each of the boards. Excuse me, three on each side. And I think it's all ready to go. So next thing is to test it. Hey guys, so here we go. Got it all put together. Went down smoothly. Got the choke secured so it's solid. Let the adhesive dry up. Got it powered on right now, so I'm not using my small power supply. I am using a different power supply. I think this one's rated for, I believe it's 50 amps at 12 volts, and I think usually the voltage measures a little bit higher. So I've got that connected to the input here. Got the remote connected right to the 12 volts, so it's on. Got a DC clamp meter on here so I can
DC current meter for the DC current. Input.
And then I've got this wired now to a slightly higher powered subwoofer. This is a Phi Q12. These are awesome. This is what I personally have in my truck. I've got a single one. So this, I believe, is rated for about 1,000 RMS conservatively and dual 2-ohm. Is it dual 2-ohm? Dual 1-ohm. Voice coils. So I've got them wired up in series now to give me 2 ohms. The reason I can't wire them parallel because it would give me 0.5 ohm, which this amplifier is not rated for a 0.5 ohm stability, guys. Please remember, you've got to do 1 ohm minimum. So 1 ohm and above to make sure you've got a good reliable operation on this amplifier. So I've currently got a 12 volt. I've got a signal generator, so I'm running off my other phone here. So I'm going to just run a 25 hertz sinusoidal, I guess not sweep, but signal to get it up and going and kind of get some power going on this puppy. Excuse all the background noise. And there it goes, you know. So we've got it moving, no issues. Again, very low power draw, so I'm going to crank it up here carefully, only about 2 amps, even though steady state was about 1.5. When it's not working. So I really need 3 hands. So let me increase power level. That's close to about 300 watts or so. There we go. Look at this thing move. I gotta lift it up so it can breathe. There we go. Look at this excursion on this puppy. I love the subwoofer. Sounds great musically. Definitely gets down to the lows. High excursion. Very, very, very accurate. And so this is almost the identical setup I have in my truck with the same identical subwoofer and same breed of amplifiers. Again, I've got a 3K RMS. And it's just a great combo. So go. Let's go up here to make sure that we're not seeing any clip indication. There you go. You've got the power, nothing running in protection, nothing running as far as clip indicator, which means you've got a clip signal, which basically turns the sine wave into more of a square wave, which overstresses the amplifier internals. So pretty cool. Got it up and running. What do we got? About 11 amps or so. So it's only about 150 watts approximately, but these DC clamp meters, this is probably a 10 plus minus 10% to 15% accuracy. So let's just assume a couple hundred watts or 150 watts and above. But look at that excursion. Doing pretty good. Power here. Of course, got
get more power. Oh, so it consumes more power when it's not breathing. All right, makes sense. Getting hotter, voice coil's getting hotter, drawing more current. Watch this. I'm gonna set it down. Not breathing, pulls more current. All right, science. Makes sense. So, here it goes. Pretty cool. Got the amp working. Obviously, it's not completely verified at full power because I don't have that capability with my bench. But certainly we'll put it in the truck, run it for a week or so, and make sure everything sounds good. And go from there. So another successful repair by Mo the Engineer. Hopefully you guys like the content. If you do, please subscribe, share. I appreciate it. Make recommendations. If there's some things that you guys want to see that you're not finding out there, let me know. But overall, great amplifiers. Do not shy away from them. Do not believe any negative reviews on these. These are great amplifiers, great power, compact size, very, very, very efficient. And if you treat them right, you can really have it last for a long time. Just follow the instructions, feed it good power, and make sure you watch your impedance and loads, all right? Thanks, guys.